This is DJ Ravenwolf with the best of hairradio.com and KCLA FM 99.3 Los Angeles and around the world on KCLAFM.com. Today we're talking about a subject that's a huge political hotspot right now. It's the topic of immigration. There's a big thing on the table about reform and all kinds of stuff where Obama, when he ran the first time, promised the Latinos that if you give me your vote, I'll give you reform, and it never happened. And then the second election, he did the same thing. And Friday, there was a huge protest out here from Sunset and Western all the way down to Gower. Wall-to-wall Latinos pissed off, protesting about this whole thing. Their stance is, we gave you the election, where's our reform? And so it's a huge political issue right now. And there is a movie out, there's a couple movies out. There's one in the theaters called Elysium, if you've ever seen it, with Matt Damon, that kind of a sci-fi take on the immigration problem. And there's another movie out starring my friend Patricia De Leon and Kristanna Loken. Oh, man. It's a rough movie, dude. It kind of pulls at your heartstrings where they're talking about... Patricia plays the wife of a man that's coming over into the country, and they cross the border with a little girl. And Kristanna plays kind of a corporate lawyer who's kind of thrust into this whole thing. And it's really interesting to see the take on... I'm not going to spoil the movie for you guys. You're going to have to see it, but it's really good. Kristanna, thank you so much for coming on the show.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
One of the things that I was looking at was a lot of these movies are really trying to play on the sympathies and the hearts. I understand people wanting a better life and wanting to come here and do better and maybe have it better than they had it. But a lot of them that come here finding out it's hard. I mean, nothing just plops into your life. I think maybe it's Hollywood's fault too, that a lot of people that watch movies think that that's how it is. Everything's magical here. You know, you get great jobs and great boyfriend, husband, whatever. And then when they come here, it's not that way. It's, you know, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of hardships here. Tell everybody first about your character in the movie and what your role is in this whole thing.
Sure. Firstly, I'd just like to say that the film is called Fighting for Freedom, and like you said, starring Patricia De Leon, Jose Maria Yazpik, Bruce Dern plays my father, and this film and subject matter, like you said, albeit a very hot topic, is something that's very near and dear to my heart, because 3/4 of the film was shot on the farm where I grew up in upstate New York.
Wow.
And we've had migrant workers that have lived and worked on the farm for the 43 years that my parents have owned it. So the plight of the immigrant is something that's all too familiar to my family. Mm-hmm. And alas, we are a country of immigrants.
Yeah.
Unless you're Native American, you are an immigrant in this country. One way or another, you're... forebears came here and brought you to this country, this land of dreams.
Right.
So the story is, like you said, it underscores one of the families that's lived and worked on my family's farm for 2 generations. They have 3 children. The 2 oldest were born on the farm, so they're citizens, and the youngest was born on a trip back to Mexico when the father's mother was dying.
Wow.
So when they re-entered the U.S., the littlest girl at the age of 2.5 faces deportation.
Right.
Where is she going to go? She's a 2.5-year-old little girl. She's not exactly a terrorist threat.
Right.
My character is not only a high-powered D.C. attorney, but she's also the farm owner's daughter and has become estranged from her father.
Sure.
So she ends up taking on the case of the immigrants and saving the humanity in that family and thus saving the humanity in her own with her own father. So what we really hope with this movie is to educate as well as entertain.
Right. Because this is something that's kind of hitting home with you, for a lot of the listeners that are on both sides of this thing, there's people for it, people against it, there's people that have visually seen with their own eyes the good and the bad of this this topic. I don't think it's ever really gone away. Back in, like I said, in the 80s, the Cubans were coming over here and dying, some of them, you know. They were coming over here in makeshift rafts that would collapse and they'd drown or whatever. I mean, people were just doing anything they could to get here. And I talked to a few people that really think that this is the land of opportunity, which it really kind of is, but there's work involved. It doesn't just, it's not Disney where it just plops into your lap and you're automatically successful. I've had a lot of people in this studio that come to LA for the first time thinking I'm gonna make it big. Doesn't matter if you're pretty, blonde hair, blue eyes. There's 1,000 girls out there pretty, blonde hair, and blue eyes. You know, you have to do something. There's a lot of people that come through this radio station that are trying to get into broadcasting for the first time because they hear it on the radio and they think, well, I could do that. They don't realize the work it takes. When you're doing this film and you've seen it on your side, what is the one thing that you could probably, I guess, impart to some of the viewers that maybe they aren't getting? Maybe they're, you know, if they've got a bias about, you know, this is my country, this is, you know, there's a lot of things going on that people maybe don't understand.
Sure.
What could you tell them about that?
Well, by no means are we advocating illegal immigration with this film. We're really trying to underscore the plight of the families that, yes, perhaps have emigrated here illegally, right, but have done exactly what you said, which is work really hard, become good, upstanding citizens, giving back to the community, and really just wanting to create a better life for themselves. From, you know, that's why they have taken, like you said, life-changing risks,
yeah,
to come over here on the raft or across the border. You know, not everybody survives that journey.
Yeah.
And in our movie, even they nearly don't.
Yeah.
And that's not too far from the truth. So, what we're advocating is the overhaul that needs to be done in Congress with the immigration crisis as we see it today and the need for comprehensive reform so that families like the Salazar in our movie can have options to legally immigrate, pay taxes, and become the citizens that they'd like to be, because right now their options are extremely limited.
Is it, I mean, everybody cries reform. I don't think anybody really understands what it means or what it entails. Do you, I don't know if you've spoken to some of the people that worked on the farm or anything like that, but what is it that, I mean, they're...
I grew up with those people.
Right. did you ever ask them, why are you taking such a big, why, is it too expensive? Is it too hard? Is it, like, is the process too long? Or, like, I mean, what's the main issue that they come here illegally?
Because they have more of an option to get here illegally than to come legally.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
That's why they do it. And the people that are coming here illegally or legally are doing the work that most Americans don't want to do. Mm-hmm. We have become a country that is extremely prideful,
yeah,
and entitled.
Yeah.
So the point is, my dad tried to hire Americans, local people. They were terrible workers.
Yeah.
They did not want to perform physical manual labor.
Yeah.
And he, obviously, getting his crop picked on time is his livelihood.
Yeah.
So he cannot take the risk to hire locals. And it's not saying that he sought out illegal immigrants to work, and the people that worked there had come through some sort of H-2A program or something that allows them to work in the country.
Right.
But this story of these people is really a microcosm of the greater whole.
Right.
And all of the families that we're hearing about today that have lived and worked in this country for 20 years, that kids are born here, they don't even, maybe some of them don't even speak Spanish, or they don't have never been to where their parents were from in Mexico.
Right.
These are the upstanding citizens that need to be given an opportunity to give back to the country that they know and love.
In doing this show for some time, just recently a friend of mine and I have kind of switched gears and we're doing a lot of the paranormal investigation stuff. We went to a place called the Pico House out in Pasadena, and across the street, there's a mass grave out there of the first settlers that, when this was a pueblo before it came to Los Angeles. Right next to that, there's a great big marker about the story of the 2 million Mexicans. When California was becoming a state, the government rounded up 2 million Mexicans, whether you were born here, whether you had a Mexican grandmother, whether your last name sounded Mexican. They rounded everybody up and got them out. And some of them weren't even allowed to come back. This was back in 1700s, 1800s, you know, and thinking that we kind of did that during World War II with the Japanese. We put them all in the internment camps and stuff. Hitler did it with all the Jews, but then, you know, we have this thing about, I don't know, it's kind of a scary thought when they can just do it, you know. When they're over here and they're working and they're trying to make a living and they're trying to better themselves, I don't know, it's because I'm not in that situation. I'm coming at it from an ignorant standpoint, but I'm hearing all the different stories about how they're, I mean, I've met a lot of folks that are working jobs that are crap and nobody would take, you know. What is probably one of the hardest things that these people are going through? Is it just staying here? Is it trying not to get found out? Is it, I mean, because a lot of them are families too.
I think it really goes back to the broken system itself.
Really?
I think if the path to citizenship were more readily available, they wouldn't have to take these alternative approaches.
Do you think it should be cheaper? I mean, I know it's like tens of thousands of dollars in some cases, where especially if you're bringing a family over here. And I know in Mexico, I don't know what it's like in other countries, but they don't make a lot of money. So do you think it's too expensive maybe, or?
That could definitely be one of the problems. I mean, in some of the points that they have on the table now seem really out of touch with reality, of having to pay all kinds of back fines and taxes that are such exorbitant rates that people would have to pay twice over their life savings, or going back to Mexico and spending time and then coming back. It just doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
So I think things need to be more concise and simpler for the immigrants, especially the ones that have been here.
Yeah. In the movie, we see Patricia and her family going through a lot of struggles, from almost dying in the desert to, you know, finally getting some work, and then the issue of her child being deported, where the political standpoint was immigration marshals came in and they were going to deport the child, and then they said, well, we can't do that or the whole country is going to come down on us. So it's the legally, yeah, they're supposed to be deported, but politically we can't do this. So there's a lot of things. Now the issue about the children, that whether they're born here or brought here or whatever, seems to be a topic. I was talking to somebody yesterday up in Palm Springs who said that, okay, what if it's a little girl or something like that? You're going to just drop her off in Mexico by herself? I mean, what are you going to do? Do you hear that kind of thing, or did you hear that kind of thing a lot when you were on the farm growing up?
Yeah. This story was inspired by actual events.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of what you're seeing actually happened.
Yeah.
And it's not dissimilar to many other stories that we pick up in the paper and
sure.
read about. So I think from a moral and ethical standpoint, like you said, where are you going to put this child?
Yeah.
And what wrong have they done other than entering a country
yeah.
with their parents, and they don't even know what a country is.
Yeah.
So yes, I did see a lot of this.
And just for the listeners and the viewers involved, if they've got questions after they watch this movie, is there a place that they can write to or maybe talk to somebody about what's going on? Even if they're listening and they are in this country illegally and they're trying to find help and find ways and avenues to, you know, I mean, yeah, you're here, now you want to do the right thing. It's you know, and I think our I don't know, the rest of the country, but California, I think they're trying to handle this. I think the governor or somebody just signed a thing where they can get driver's licenses now and stuff like that. The Dream Act for people that want to get an education.
Absolutely.
I think we're trying to deal with it, but I don't think maybe it's not enough. But
and just to piggyback on what you're saying earlier about the protests that you saw in the street here on the weekend, the Dream Act is very, very important, and I really believe that a lot of the immigrant students that we're seeing, the children that are here by parents who are illegal, are striving that much harder to get an opportunity to ensure a good education. And to be able to give them that experience, this is our next generation of upstanding Americans and citizens. It's very, very important. And also, I agree, comprehensive reform is necessary. I mean, with the government shutdown and everything that's going on, it's like Obama has so much on his plate right now. And I think this has been a broken system that has not happened overnight. It's been through a number of presidencies. Mm-hmm. So it's going to take him a little bit of time, especially with the opposing sides in government, to really put something together, which unfortunately the frustration, as you see from these people, is taking longer than they want. But I definitely believe that within his second term he will get the job done.
When you've been in movies for a while and in television, I've got a lot of friends overseas where they see, especially in Iran, my friend Sanaa, she's from Iran, but she lives here, and she's been in this country since she was a kid. Over there, they see our movies, and they think that's how things are over here. Do you think maybe Hollywood has a bit of a guilty thing to play in this whole, you know, like this is the magic land of opportunity, when people come here realizing they're working harder than they've ever worked? Is there something, I mean, I know we're just probably breaking the subject now with your movie and with Elysium and a few others maybe. I think Machete even dealt with it in a bloody way. But Hollywood's still kind of portraying this, I don't know, it's I got a feeling that we're sending the wrong message. If you come here, it's not Disneyland. There's things you got to do.
Well, I think there's two points that I want to bring up. One is to answer your previous question, which is, yes, if listeners or viewers have questions for me in particular or want more information, they can certainly get in touch with me via my website, which is kristannaloken.net. And I think that's also why we were inspired to make this film. I mean, I've done a lot of... You talk about Elysium, kind of highlighting that in a science fiction way, which is really great, but you're still dealing in the realm of fantasy, and that's a genre that I've done a lot of, is the action, fantasy, sci-fi world, which is very fun and freeing and liberating, because you can create and do whatever you'd like, and it doesn't really have to make a lot of sense. But on the adverse side, fighting for freedom has to make sense, and that's why we made it. That's why I started this company, Loken Man Productions, was to make films that educate as well as entertain. And when I saw the masses that could be reached through the medium of television and film, it really inspired me to say, hey, if all these people are going to watch the movie, and yes, that is a journey and a piece of escapism, and it is serving a purpose, and I love my art and my craft and what I do, why not do something that really has merit and has note? And at the end of the day, this is about humanity. This is about people coming to this country looking for a better life, who we've seen so much fear generated and racism and xenophobia, and this is across the globe. I mean, every country has their immigration issues. We are a global economy now. We are a global world. People are moving all over. They're not just going to stay in one country now. So this is something that really needs to end, and we have to stop looking at the fear that is the difference between us and look at the similarities and what we find the fear within those similarities. And I think that's one of the most important messages of this film.
Yeah, I've spoken to people over in Romania and other countries where if you go into that country and you're new or whatever, your first thing is they sign you up into the military for at least 1 to 2 years to earn your keep. You know, if you're going to be here, you're going to fight for our country. That was an issue somebody else brought up a few months ago, that, you know, they wanted to work and they're taking advantage of the school system and put them in the military where they can be trained for electronics and for communications, for some really cool stuff. At the same time, they're, you know, earning their citizenship. You know, that was one option. There was a couple of other options where a lot of these people coming here have skills for teaching and things like that. They could set up schools. That was another thing we discovered when we were at the Pico House. Right next to that, I guess it used to be a hotel back in the day, but there's a Chinese American Museum. The Chinese Museum, it was basically, if you go, there's an underground city in Pasadena right there, where the Chinese, when they came over here, there was gang violence, the Mexicans were, you know, fighting, killing, shooting, all this other stuff. So the Chinese went underground. The tunnels are still there. They've got schools and shops and all kinds of stuff, because that was the only way for them to live. They had to hide. And so what you're saying with, yeah, this hasn't gone away. This is still something going on, like, you know.
History will repeat itself until it doesn't, until we stop it. And we have to be the ones now to evoke the change. Otherwise, it'll keep repeating.
For those of you listening, we're talking to Kristanna Loken. And I know a lot of you guys were writing in about the Terminator thing. It's been a long time since that movie came out, man. Go around killing folks and stuff. one of the guys was asking about the sci-fi movie back in the day compared to all the stuff they got now, which is, you know, digitally, it's crazy what they can make appear on a screen and make it look real. What was the process of doing the Terminator movies where, I guess, yeah, they had to like put all kinds of weird digitized stuff on you and things like that?
Yeah, I mean, we shot most of the movie practically, meaning what you see is what you get. I mean, yeah. We really shot that. Of course, there were, at the time when Matrix, I think it was number 2, was being released almost simultaneously to Terminator 3, we did have as many CGI shots as Matrix had.
Wow.
But when you look at it, it looks a lot less sci-fi, if you will. It looks a lot more realistic.
Yeah.
But, for example, the plasma cannon that I had on my arm, we had a prosthetic that I actually wore.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, the actual cannon coming out of it, things like that, that's CG.
Sure.
We did go up to, Light and Sound, George Lucas's Light and Sound, which is up in San Francisco, where they photographed me. Not photographed, but it was a camera that takes pictures in 3D, moving pictures.
Right.
So there I wore a black kind of cat suit, if you will, with various tracking markers so that they could film me in 3D and then lay the animatronics over top of my movements. So when I'm getting squished at the end by the big door that comes down, and you see my face kind of morph and the endoskeleton and whatever, that's what they did with the CGI there.
Wow.
But a lot of it we really shot practically. I mean, even all the crane stuff we shot practically. That epic chase sequence, we shot out at a hangar, an old airplane hangar in Downey, where they recreated a whole street during that chase scene. And that sequence when Arnold is on the edge of the crane, I think the ladder on the crane, and he gets blasted through the buildings. I mean, clearly they didn't blast Arnold through the buildings,
yeah.
But they did demolish those buildings that right. They had built for that. So that was
sounds like it's a lot more work than just acting and stuff. There's a lot of detail that goes out, putting on the suit, putting on the track, and doing all the stuff, and then you know,
oh yeah, absolutely.
I've been on films where they've had to do like they'll shoot one scene over and over and over again, 15-hour, 16-hour day, and just from this angle, from that angle, this light, that light. Oh, God, we're getting it done. When you're shooting something, I had somebody else on that was in one of the Saw movies, and it took them like 6 weeks to shoot that thing, and then all the rest of the movie was like backflash stuff. They just added crap in there and it was done. How long did it take you guys to shoot a movie like that?
It was 5 months.
Wow, really?
It was 100 days, shooting days, yeah. So it was, that's a very long shoot for a movie.
Was it shot here? Yeah.
We shot all of it here, yeah.
I know a lot of them start shooting in Canada now and other places and stuff like that.
The original plan was Vancouver, but Arnold really wanted to be close to home, so.
Yeah, man. Oh, and was that like I'm probably guessing that was probably your breakthrough movie role?
It was. Yeah. I mean, I started working professionally at 13. My first job was on As the World Turns soap opera.
Wow.
I had played like the speed age daughter, you know how they speed age characters on soaps, of Meg Ryan.
Wow.
So she had left the show, and when she left, I think her daughter was maybe 5, and then like a couple years later, I arrive and I'm 13.
That's amazing.
I'm the same daughter.
Wow.
The same character. So that's how I started. And then really it just snowballed from there. So by the time T3 came around, I had done quite a bit of work in television and film. But that was, that was the big breakthrough for me.
Man. And what kind of things are you doing now outside of this movie? Are you in television? Are you doing another film? Or what's coming up for you?
Yeah, I got quite a few other things happening. One, we're obviously very excited. This has really been a product of a labor of love for me. And I should mention that it was written by my father. I don't know if I mentioned that yet. Yeah, my dad wrote it, Chris Loken. He's a novelist and screenwriter, among many other things. And so it was really special working with him in such a close dynamic on this. And of course, the legendary Bruce Dern, who's been in this business for 50 years and nominated for an Academy Award. Honestly, it was one of the best acting experiences I've had to date, was working with such a legend.
Yeah, he really brings a passion to that character too. You can feel the despair from him, you can feel his frustration with everything, and he's just trying to make a living, he's trying to help people at the same time. Was that, I guess, a similar experience with you and your father when you go working on a farm?
I think there's a bit of truth in creative work, obviously, when it comes from a place that's so close to home, but there's also a certain amount of artistic freedom, if you will. And my dad and I have a very close relationship. We didn't have a falling out like the characters in the film. However, I do think, secretly, he did always want to have a son, not so secretly, that could take over the farm after he'd put in 43 years. They just sold it, so it was quite special. That was the last season that we got to immortalize the farm in, which was really neat, and the surrounding area in which I grew up, Hudson, New York.
Yeah.
And Bruce now is totally having this renaissance in his career. He's also coming out with Alexander Payne's new film, Nebraska, which looks like he might be getting an Oscar nod for. So fingers crossed. He already won the Best Acting Award at the Cannes Film Festival, the Palme d'Or.
Very cool.
So, and he's just such a nice man. So what's next is we definitely have more plans for our company, Loken Man Productions. We have a couple other films on our slate. One, they're both actually adapted from novels that my father wrote. One is based, again, or let's say inspired by actual events, and it delves into the mind of a psychosexual serial killer.
Okay.
And I grew up listening to these audio tapes of him interviewing the actual killer, and it was eerie, let me tell you. So that's The Boy Next Door, and then the other film that we have upcoming is called Come Monday Morning, and this is a slice of life film written in real time, so it's more like you're reading, you're watching the mind of this man unfold over the course of a weekend, and he's an alcoholic.
Yeah.
So everything is about come Monday morning, I'll do this, I'll do that, and all the trivialities that he has to go through and deal with over that weekend. And it's a very tragically beautiful story of anyone in small-town America. The guy who was the head quarterback on the football team and is still holding on to that dream for the rest of his life, sitting at the end of the bar.
Yeah.
We all know someone like that.
Yeah.
So that's on my the personal side of my company. On the other side of things, I did a pilot presentation, which is a half-hour dramedy called Hollywood Bump and Grind. And it's about
Miley Cyrus.
Pretty much. No, it's about a couple of young actresses right here in Hollywood. My character is the slightly more established actress who is showing the ropes to her younger cousin, who's here from Norway, who's starting out as an actress as well.
Yeah.
And my character is recovering from a bad cocaine addiction.
Wow.
And all the nasty characters that she has to tread in the sharky waters of Hollywood, if you will.
Yeah.
it's very funny. We've got Kevin Farley in it, who's a great comedic actor. David Leisure as well, and myself. So we've got that going, and looks like I've got another film that is going to be in the sci-fi action realm called Hunted.
Hunted?
Hunted.
What's that one about? Sounds pretty nasty.
Yeah, Hunted is about a... my character is a CIA... Special Forces agent.
Mm-hmm.
Never played one of those before.
You never played a girly girl. Help me. You always play.
No,
I'm gonna
kill you. Stress. Exactly. Give Kristanna a gun and she'll be just fine. And whose job is basically to babysit this group of mercenaries who have been hired to transport some weapons.
Yeah.
But let's just say the plan doesn't go accordingly to what they think that their task is.
Mm-hmm.
And they run into some not-so-human adversaries along
Sweet.
The way that they have to fight and overtake. So this will be a very fun action, a lot of action, action-packed ride.
Very cool. Those of you listening, talking to Kristanna, I got Swedish on my bubble. We're going to go ahead and wrap this thing up because we're about running out of time. One more time, give the email address or a website that these people can get a hold of you about this film.
Yes. I'm promoting Fighting for Freedom, and it opens this weekend at the NoHo Lemley. And you can find out more information on my website, kristannaloken.net. Or on my Facebook page, Loken Kristanna, to learn more of the details. But we're opening on Friday, and it'll be there all week.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Thank you so much for coming on the show. I know it's a personal subject, and it's a really hot political topic right now. And I urge everybody to go check this film out if you can. Will it be available online as well at some point, or is it just going to be in the theaters?
It should be, yes, it should be. But to get the full experience...
Yeah.
It's always best to check it out on the big screen.
Yeah, go see it. I'm telling you, it'll tug at your heartstrings, I promise. DJ Ravenwolf with the Best of Hair Radio.com. We'll see you guys all again right here on the Best of Hair.